Hello friends, in the series of learning computer organization and design, today we are going to learn about the cache memory. So as usual, let's discuss the overview of today's session. So we have already covered the topic in the memory organization, like memory hierarchy, main memory, auxiliary memory, and associative memory. So the entirely in today's session, we will focus on the cache memory. So I will simply introduce you with the topic, because cache memory is a little lengthy topic. So I have simply planned that we will segment this topic of cache memory in two parts. So today's session is purely based on the introduction part. But in the upcoming session, we will learn certain mapping techniques. So this is how I have divided this session. So let's start understanding about what is the cache memory and why is it important? How does the cache memory helps in providing the better access time to the machine? So here is very first slide. So you can see that the cache memory is basically residing between the CPU and the main memory. Because normally when the CPU is operating its normal operation, so it always refers to the main memory, right, for getting any kind of data. Same is the case, main memory also refers the CPU for any further assistance. Now the point is that the access time to get the data from the main memory, it might be longer due to many reasons. Like we know that main memory being large in the size, right, it will take maybe one or two memory cycles to get the data which is been available in this main memory. But there are certain types of the operations, or there is a certain kind of data or certain kind of programs are which are existing within the system that requires some less access time. Okay, so they cannot afford like they will be sparing one or two memory cycles just to get the data only. So for such kind of cases, what we are doing is nearby the CPU, we are placing the cache memory. Now the property of cache memory is that the data which is in main memory is the only data which is copied here. This is the first point. Second point is that its size is very small in comparison to the main memory. And thirdly, so just because it is having the small size, the access time to get the data actually increases, because whenever we are accessing the data, or you could say finding the data from the small place, it is easy to get that, right? Also, as it is lying nearby the CPU, so it is simply helping the system in order to increase the average memory access time of the computer. So basically, as I said earlier, it is placed between the CPU and the main memory. So it is a faster component in the hierarchy. So definitely this is the main property which cache is consisting of. It is a very fast kind of memory. It is considered the faster memory in the among all the memory hierarchy memories, and approaches the speed of CPU components. So whenever the CPU will need the memory access, what will happen? The CPU will always first approach the cache memory. If the data is present or available in the cache memory, then it will simply take data from here. What if for any reason the data is not been present here, only then the CPU will refer the main memory to get that data. Okay, so let's suppose some data which the CPU was intending to get in the cache memory is not present. So what will happen? In the next memory cycle, that block of data will be taken from the main memory and will be shifted to this cache memory. So certain procedure is being used for what kind of data is actually been stored here in the cache memory. So this is what we are going to learn now. So the topic is, or the heading is, the locality of reference. So guys, my point here is that the point is, what kind of data is usually stored in cache memory? Okay, this is the question. So for that, we are learning this topic. So now the point is that I simply said the data which is residing in the cache memory is the same data which is already available in the main memory. But again, what is the criteria being used in order to place the data here in the cache memory? So usually it has been said that the data which is frequently being accessed by the system, okay, that kind of data is been residing here. So again, let's understand in more detail about what is this locality of reference and how does it helps in providing the frequently accessed data from the main memory into the cache memory. So the references to the memory at given interval tend to be confined with the localized area. So this is some important aspect. Whenever the user is referencing the main memory, so usually what happens is that there is some local area upon which that user is referencing the memory. Like let's suppose this is some data being stored here, 20, and at the location of, at the address bar 50, 51, 52, so on and so forth, right? Now the point is that if right now this data is being searched, so the local area to this data is having the more chances that it will be searched or it will be taken by the system, okay? So this is what we are calling as the locality of reference. Means what is the area which is the local area of reference of the memory, or you could say that a reference of the memory which has been required, which can be required in near future. So this area contains a set of information. Definitely, sometimes what happens is the, like if we are running some subroutine or we are running some loop kind of condition, so that conditions are being, or that kind of data is placed always together. So whenever we are searching one kind of data, then the chances or the probability of accessing the data which is lying nearby, or which is the data which is as relevant or as similar kind of data, that chances becomes higher. So this kind of data is basically being stored in the cache memory. Okay, so this is this procedure is basically called as the locality of reference. So usually, again, if I answer you this, so this is some locality. Okay, so we are referring, let's suppose this particular data 20 here. So there are chances that the upcoming data 21 or the 19, okay, which is lying nearby, in which is local to this particular data that we are accessing right now, will be accessed in the near future. So this property is actually known as locality of reference. This is what is the point. So usually the CPU or the cache memory is taking the locality of reference into picture before storing the data in the cache memory. So normally there are two types of localities which we can make. One is the temporal locality. So temporal locality says the information which is used in near future is likely to be in use already. So let's suppose right now we are accessing this data in the main memory, okay? So maybe in near future, I will be using the data 20 or maybe 21 and 19. We are using this data right now. This is temporal, right? So in near future might be the case that we will be using the data 21, 19, or even the 20. So what we will do, this kind of you could say data, okay, or this kind of loop, this is a loop 19, 20, 21, okay, that we will refer as the temporal locality. This is coming under that. When we know that this particular loop may be used in near future as well, so we will place this data in the cache memory. Similarly is the spatial locality. In case of spatial, what happen is spatial case, if a word is accessed, so right now I am accessing a word 20, so adjacent words are likely accessed soon, so there are chances that the word number 19 or 21 will also be accessed in the near future. Then we will call it as the spatial locality. Okay, depending upon just the adjacent positions of the data, we figure out that, okay, this kind of data also need to be placed in the cache memory. So usually what happens is always the data which is related to each other is stored together. So this is, we know that in the main memory, the data is always being provided in an organized manner. So usually the instructions are executed in a sequential order only. So that is why there are two types of locality of reference facilities through which we are storing the data in the cache memory. So if the active portion of the program and data are placed in a fast small memory, so what is the meaning of this term, temporal and spatial? So basically, we know that if it is a temporal kind of data, means a loop has been there, which we are accessing, and we think that in near future, we need to access this loop. So instead of placing that data in the main memory, why not to place this active data, this kind of data in the cache memory? Because in the main memory, it will take a lot of time to get that data. So if we are placing the data in the cache memory, it will take less time to get the same data. So that is why we are using the property of locality of reference here. So if we are placing such kind of data in the cache memory, then the average access time can be reduced at a much higher level. So reducing the total execution time of the program, such small fast small memory is referred as the cache memory. So this is what is the point here. It is basically been used to overcome the execution time of a program. So that is why we are using the locality of the reference feature here. So after understanding the locality of reference, here is a time when we need to focus on how well the cache memory is performing within the machine. Or you could say, what is the performance? How to calculate the performance of the cache memory? So usually we are calculating the performance in terms of hit ratio. This is what has been required. So we will be learning the hit ratio here. It is simply being denoted by H. Before that, this point is very important. Whenever CPU is referring the memory, okay, and finds the data, let's suppose this is the CPU and here is the cache memory. And here it is the main memory. So usually what will happen? In order to get any data, CPU will first look into the cache memory. If the data is present here, okay, then I will say it is a cache hit. This is the term we use. We call it as a cache hit. CPU was looking for some data in the cache memory and the data was present. So we call it as a cache hit. If CPU is looking for a memory, but in the cache memory, but data is not present here, then I will call it as a miss or a cache miss. So these are the two terminologies being used, which will help me in determining the hit ratio. Okay. So what is the hit ratio here? Hit ratio, or usually it has been denoted by small h, is the total number of hits in the cache memory divided by hits plus misses. Okay. So this is what is the hit ratio that we need to determine. So if the hit ratio, usually it has been considered that 0.9% of hit ratio can be considered as a very good kind of ratio. So hit ratio is the percentage of the memory access satisfied by the cache memory system. So this is how we are getting it. So here is a one numerical also that is coming here. So we are calculating the effective memory access time in the cache memory. What is the effective memory access time? So effective time will be cache access time and the main memory access time, okay, along with the hit ratio. So the cache memory access time plus 1 minus, this value of h should always be less than 1, and maximum equals to 1 only. It can be equals to less than and equal to 1. It could never exceed the 1, okay? So that is why it is 1 minus h into the tm. So TC is here, which is the time I have used to access the cache memory. TM is the time taken to access the main memory. 1 minus h, h is the hit ratio, okay? So if some values of TC, TM, and h is given, accordingly, we can calculate the effective access time in the cache memory system. So this is what has been required here. So after analyzing the performance of the cache and after determining the hit ratios, hits, misses, effective time, so now is the time to determine how we can update the data in the cache memory. So usually writing or updating the data in the cache memory is done in two methods. There are two writing methods being used. One is the write through. Write through means this is the simplest method, and usually it has been used within the cache memory. What happens in the write through method is, now data is placed in the cache as well as in the main memory. And we know that the data which is present in the cache memory is actually the copied data. Means the same data is placed here in the main memory. So what happens whenever we are updating any of the contents in the cache, the same content in the main memory is also being updated at the same time, or in parallel you could say. Then we call it as a write through. Throughout it is getting written. So whenever we are updating the data in the cache memory, it will also be updated in the main memory or wherever it has been located. So this method has an advantage that the main memory always contains the same data as the cache memory. Okay, so this is the first point, and commonly we are using this method. But yes, we are having another kind of method too, which is we calling as the write back. Now, what is this write back method? So we are having a cache memory, and here is the main memory. So what is happening is, in this method, only the cache location is updated during the write. Let's suppose you want to perform some write operation on the data. Okay, so you will only provide a write here. You have written this data and this data and this data. This data at the same time will not get reflected in the main memory. This is what the point is. It is write back. Okay, so what has happened? Let's suppose you have updated this data. So some flag will be generated here that once the entire updation is done in the cache memory, and then only we will be updating the data in the main memory. So the location is then marked by a flag. Okay, we are using the flag bits that these are the locations where we need to update the data, so that later when the word is removed from the cache, is copied it to the main memory. So only at the time when we need to copy the data into the main memory, only at that time we will be writing or updating the data. So why we are using it? The reason for write back method is that during the time a word resides in a cache, it may be updated several times, right? So this could be the case also, like whenever we are having some temporary data being stored. So again, the cache is the main, the first memory where we are accessing the data, or where the CPU will access the data first before the main memory. So definitely, if the data is intermediately changing or it is a temporary kind of data, it might be the case that it is getting updated a number of times. So in that case, we are using the write back method. So otherwise, in total, we can write the data in two forms, write through method and the write back method. So with this, students, I hope that you have understood today's session. Thank you so much for joining this session.